Let me begin with what may be obvious. Is this story of Israel and Hamas, the story of the Arab world, different for you?
Yeah, it is, Charlie, for two reasons. But first of all, let me say how happy I am to be back in conversation with you. We go back a long way.
In many capitals.
In many, many capitals. I remember calling you from Cairo during the Arab Spring and calling in. And so it's great to have you back and enriching the conversation.
Thank you.
It's different for two reasons, technology and mendacity. The technology point is that we're in the age of social networks. And so every war now is a world war. In fact, I called the Ukraine-Russia war World War I, and I called the Israel-Hamas war World War II. Those things we called World War I, World War II back in 1914, 1918, those actually weren't world wars in the way they are now. I mean, half the world was colonized back then. These are real world wars. Everyone can watch on a smartphone. Everyone can opine. Everyone, because the world's so wired, is touched one way or another, whether it's by higher shipping costs from the Bab el-Mandeb because of what the Houthis are doing, or higher fertilizer costs in Argentina because they've lost their supply of fertilizer from Russia and Ukraine. These are really world wars, number one. And so they tend to get amplified in ways that previous Middle East wars I covered didn't do. But the second reason, the thing that is new, is that this war, Charlie, is being driven by the worst of the worst on both sides. So Hamas as an organization always had a kind of pragmatic wing and a military wing. And I don't want to exaggerate the difference between them, but there was always a trend within Hamas that spoke in favor of maybe a long-term truce with Israel, never recognizing the Jewish state, but what they called a hudna, a long-term truce, you know. And then you have the military wing now driven by Yahya Sinwar, former prisoner in Israeli prisons for actually killing Palestinians, Palestinian informers, who a lot of people think is a psychopath, in fact. So Hamas, the Palestinian side, is being driven by the worst of the worst. And we saw that reflected on October 7th with things I'd never seen before. Mass rape, the maiming of people, shooting parents in front of their kids and kids in front of their parents, kidnapping two-year-olds and four-year-olds and grandparents. And so it's being driven by the worst of the worst on the Palestinian side. It's being driven by the worst of the worst on the Israeli side. I don't compare them. These are not people who engaged in rape or that kind of blatant barbarous murder. But this is driven by the far right in Israel that basically has politically kidnapped Netanyahu and made it that he really can't do anything they don't agree with. This is sort of the Jewish supremacists, Smotrich, the finance minister, and Ben-Gvir, the national security minister. And they basically want to level Gaza. And so it's the Jews who believe Israel should control everything from the river to the sea, and the Palestinians who believe Palestinians should control everything from the river to the sea. And they're now in the driver's seat in both communities. And so you really see, you know, the most intense kind of violence, and then all amplified by TikTok and social media. And that's what makes this different.
Who's winning?
It's a good question. It's a good Charlie Rose question, you know. And one has to answer that on many levels. Israel has inflicted enormous damage to Hamas's infrastructure and military ranks. We don't know exactly, but they've probably killed thousands of fighters, and they've certainly uncovered and destroyed scores of tunnels, which are the basic infrastructure of the Hamas military. At the same time, because Hamas embedded itself among Palestinian civilians, Israel has killed thousands of innocent Gazans and displaced them, made them refugees again, basically, within Gaza. And this has created a huge global backlash against Israel. And so this has not been, the military victory has been certainly tempered by the huge diplomatic victory, and more than diplomatic, a loss of popular support among, among people who were either neutral or thought Israel was a friend, considered it a friend. You see families breaking up over this. You see generations breaking up over this. You see dorm rooms breaking up over this. This war has put Israel in a light and under a light that has never been before. And so, wars are fought, Charlie, for political ends. And the political end that Hamas has achieved is a recent poll we had. I think it showed that 84% of Americans, supported Israel in this war, but 16% were all 16 to 24 year olds who did not support Israel in this war. So Israel's actually lost a generation. But at the same time, I believe there'll be a delayed reaction on the Palestinian side. I've just written a column, saying that Israel should get out of Gaza and force Yahya Sinwar to come out. I mean, it should actually say we will get out of Gaza if we get all our hostages back. And there is a ceasefire that's internationally supervised. But if it does, and Yahya Sinwar, the leader of Hamas, has to come out of his hiding, the morning after he comes out, I'm sure he will be carried on the shoulders of people, and they will shout Allahu Akbar, and he will claim to have held off the Jewish army for over 2 months. The morning after that, I believe a lot of Gazans will say, what the hell were you thinking? Right. What destruction you have wrought? What was your goal? What was the plan? Whose permission did you ask? And now how are you going to rebuild my house?
How are you going to be in my house? How am I going to find another job? Because I can no longer go to Israel or to Egypt, to wherever I might have been going.
There's a reckoning.
Provide for my family. Where's my job?
Yeah. No, I think he's going to face all of that. And the sooner Israel gets out, I think that he will. And so, who's winning? There's no winner here, the only winning will be is if we can get back to a discussion and a movement toward two states for two people where both can feel secure in their own space. And we're so far away from that now, Charlie, that right now, in that sense, everybody's a loser. Charlie, I've never covered a war where more people tell me they don't sleep at night on all sides. It's really penetrated people's psyche. And I understand why. It's every Israeli mom's nightmare that their daughter would be dragged off into a Hamas tunnel. And Israel was supposed to be the answer for Jewish insecurity. And now so many Israeli Jews feel insecure. And so many Gazans fear a bomb can drop out of the sky at any moment, whether they're in a safe spot or a designated safe spot or not. And they can be turned into refugees a second time inside Gaza, having to move from north to south or south to north. And so there's something truly nightmarish, diabolically nightmarish about the whole thing.
Is the goal of Netanyahu and his colleagues in the government to find all the leadership and arrest or kill it? Is that possible?
Yeah, I don't think it's possible at a price that either the world or Israel would tolerate, because the price for Israel could be the loss of all the remaining hostages, some 130. And the price that the world would have to look away from would be the further devastation and immiseration of Gaza, and surely the deaths of thousands more people. So I don't think that's a realistic goal. I think Israel should step back, realize that it has inflicted enormous pain and punishment on Hamas, degraded its capabilities, and look to find deterrence through that. And the fact that Sinwar will have to come out and face his people. And there's already a discussion inside Palestinian politics about who should lead, whether he should lead, what he did, new coalitions. Mm-hmm. And I certainly think Israel should give that a chance and give itself a chance.
What's interesting about your proposal, as I understand it, is that there is no prisoner exchange.
Right.
You're simply saying the IDF will withdraw. You give us our prisoners. You give us the hostages. And you can have Gaza. You provide for it. And you provide the services. You provide the government. We're withdrawing. But we're keeping all those Palestinian prisoners.
Okay, we're not going to reward you with Palestinian prisoners. We'll reward you with leaving and a ceasefire, which let us remember, because there's all this talk about ceasefire. Israel didn't break the ceasefire on October 7th. Hamas did. There was a ceasefire on October 7th, negotiated from the last war. And so, I just think, from the very beginning, Charlie, one of the things I said and wrote is that Israel should ask itself what its worst enemies wanted to do and do the opposite. And can you imagine the disappointment in Tehran, in Hezbollah land, in Hamas land, in Houthi land, if Israel withdrew from Gaza as part of a ceasefire and got its hostages back? Because what all these countries want, Charlie, is for Israel to be morally, economically, militarily, and diplomatically overstretched. If it's overstretched in this way, it's vulnerable because then Hamas and the Houthis and Hezbollah can all say, hey, we're justified in what we're doing. It's weakened on the inside and it's delegitimized globally.
And it's causing strains among Israel and its friends and especially the United States.
Exactly. It's causing strain with Israel's maybe most friendly U.S. president ever, Joe Biden. And it's causing strains with all of its allies, and particularly its Arab allies. It's a huge problem for Egypt, for Jordan, for the Abraham Accord countries in the Gulf. And so I just think that chasing this shimmer, and I do believe it is a shimmer of wiping Hamas off the face of the earth. I said early on, Charlie, that the four most dangerous words in the Middle East are once and for all. We're going to fix this thing once and for all.
Yeah.
It's, you don't have the power, nobody does, to fix anything there once and for all. You have to live with a certain ambiguity. And sometimes you want to be smart and use the leverage of forcing people to take responsibility in different ways and not thinking because every problem is a nail and you have a hammer, that's the only thing you can do.
When you're there, tell me about your friends and conversations, first with just regular people and how it's affecting them. What are they saying to themselves about the future? What are they saying about deterrence? What are they saying about where they want to live? What are they saying about the kind of government they want? Israel.
So, of course, it all depends who you talk to. But as a general matter, there's a huge shock at the intelligence and military failure here, which is of mammoth proportions, that Hamas was able to plan this, to acquire the weapons industry that they clearly had acquired, and then execute it in the way they did, without being detected until it was too late, is a massive military failure in terms of the border defense and a massive intelligence failure in terms of anticipation.
But did they fail to know or fail to heed what was there? I'm thinking about the reporting of Ronan Bergman, and those who were part of the intelligence apparatus around Gaza.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's a combination of things. One Israeli general told me that for all of this to have succeeded by Hamas, seven things had to go wrong. It was a cascade. Yeah. It was a cataclysmic failure. And had any one of them not gone wrong, it would have been vastly minimized. But they all went wrong, not unlike 9/11. And I'm sure for Hamas, it was a catastrophic success in that they succeeded far more than they ever anticipated. Who knew there'd be a dance with some 300 Israeli 20-year-olds, just across the border? And I don't think there's no indication they knew that was going to happen. And so, because of that, there's been a loss of trust in the army and the government in general. And so that confidence will have to be restored. At the same time, This has real strategic consequences because people in northern Israel and now on the Gaza front don't want to go back to their homes. So you have thousands of internal exiles now in Israel. I visited the members of Kibbutz Be'eri, one of the kibbutzim that was ravaged by Hamas. They were living in a hotel on the Dead Sea. It's bizarre. You know, you go down to the Dead Sea and there's an entire community there living in a hotel, 700 people with a makeshift school and a kindergarten here. And so the country is not right, you know. And at the same time, I'm in a hotel in Tel Aviv and I get in the elevator and talking to the people in the elevator, where you're from, they're from Kiryat Shmona on the northern border. Yeah. And they've left. So the country has shrunk in a way. And that's not sustainable either. And so there's just a lot of the country, it took a blow to the head, Israel, you know. And certainly Palestinians in Gaza have taken an enormous blow to the head. The only silver lining, and I don't mean in any way to minimize the devastation that both have encountered, but the only silver lining is maybe now people have just so looked into the abyss that if nothing else, they will get back to another attempt, which I believe they will eventually, at two states for two people. I don't know when. But I do believe there'll be another go at this.
Well, you've got to have a government that they agree on. And I assume that means a lot of selling of the Palestinian Authority.
Yeah, I think there'll be a revamp Palestinian Authority. I think there'll be a revamp PLO, because I think there'll be an attempt to reunify the Palestinian decision-making front that Hamas broke away from. I think it's important that there be an Islamist representation in that PLO umbrella, because you want, if you're Israel, to be able to actually make a peace that will be applied by the other side universally. Not make the mistake of dividing the Palestinians as was done before. So there'll have to be, you don't want to do de-Ba'athification as we did in Iraq. That didn't work out too well. You obviously, any Hamas-like person, I want to say, who is ready to accept Oslo, I think, you know, you'd want them part of this process. Obviously not killers and people with blood on their hands, and I totally understand that. But you want a legitimate Palestinian united front to negotiate with Israel. I think that's going to take time, but I think it could come out of this process. At the same time, I do believe Prime Minister Netanyahu will be removed. I don't know when or how. I think there'll be a groundswell of support for ousting him the minute the fighting does die down. And some would say that's why he doesn't want it to die down, because I think there's a great anger at him for dividing the country with his judicial coup before this happened, indulging the settlers and requiring the army to move troops from the Gaza front to the West Bank front, dividing Palestinians by building up Hamas as a counterweight to the Palestinian Authority, the people who did accept Oslo.
And taking pride in the fact that there has been no two-state solution.
Exactly. So everything.
And taking not only pride, but credit.
Yeah, I think Netanyahu will go down as not only the worst leader in Israel's history, but surely one of the worst leaders in Jewish history. And our history is long.
Among the people making the decision today, there is obviously a united front. Because you're at war and people are rallying. But how much difference are there about what Israel should be doing along the lines of the alternatives? You wrote about a red and a blue team, suggesting, you know, there ought to be somebody, you know, looking at the proposals on the table and maybe offering other proposals. How much of that is happening?
Not enough, in my view. I feel like when this happened, and I understand it was a shock. And there was just a desire for raw revenge.
Does that still exist?
I think it's been tempered now to some degree. But, you know, I used a quote from Confucius one day that if you start a war of revenge, dig two graves, because, you know, one will be for you.
From the our revenge is best served cold.
Right. And well, one of the things that worried me from the very beginning, Charlie, was two things that worried me, why I was so wary of launching. And one was it was clear to me the Israeli elite, the political military elite, was not together. Okay, they were not together. You had these right wingers in Netanyahu's cabinet. You had the Likud people. You had military people at contempt. You had for these right wingers. You had the intelligence community that had contempt for these right wingers. If you're going to war, you want to really, as much as possible, a unified elite. That worried me. And the other was that there was no defined political objective. What did winning look like? What did the morning after look like? What are we trying to build in Gaza? The reason that couldn't be articulated was because, assuming that would require a Palestinian partner to help govern Gaza, like the Palestinian Authority, Netanyahu couldn't say that because his right-wing partners refused to have the PA, the Palestinian Authority, that embraced Oslo as part of any a morning after political settlement for Gaza. So Israel launched a war with no political objective, and the army knows that, and increasingly is chafing at that, because I think the army sees itself as moving to a new phase where it really pulls back closer to the border and does more tactical strategic strikes, both to relieve the humanitarian crisis there and the fact that you have 360,000 reservists mobilized for Israel. That's the key members of their economy. And so the economy is really starting to feel it. Israel just can't go on like this to wipe Hamas off the face of the earth. If it takes another 6 months or a year, it would be enormously devastating to the Israeli economy.
You know, you constantly have to remember how Israel is a country of, 10 million people?
9 million, yeah.
9 to 10 million.
7 million. 7 million Jews and 2 million Israeli Arabs.
When you look at the future, how is the world opinion that exists now on the Arab street going to be a limiting restraint on what's possible?
Well, you have a lot of complexity there now, Charlie, more than one would suspect. I was in Saudi Arabia, and Saudis pointed out to me that they had just had their annual, it's called Riyadh season, which is their annual cultural festival that they have now in Saudi Arabia. Global singers, dancers, film festival, the Red Sea Film Festival. It's a big, big sort of cultural event in Saudi Arabia. And they had that despite the Gaza war. And there was a number of attacks on them, particularly out of Kuwait and Egypt and other places, for basically going through their normal cultural life and not pausing for the Gaza war. And so you see a lot of strains now. There's a lot of fed upness in the Gulf, if I might say, with the whole Palestinian issue and a real desire there to move on, manifested by the Abraham Accords and the Saudi proposal for normalization with Israel. So there is that difference now. But people there very much identify with obviously the plight of innocent Gazans.
20,000.
Yeah, I mean, the thousands of people who've been killed and injured and displaced. And so, but it's more of a mixed picture. I wrote about being in Riyadh, walking through the Aldea Mall and being stopped by a shopkeeper who, really wanted me to know that, they cared enormously about what was happening to Gazan civilians. What Hamas did was not okay with the Prophet Muhammad, that he would never sanction kidnapping children and grandparents, let alone rape, and really wanted to make sure I understood that.
But can governments say that?
No, the two governments did, Bahrain and the United Arab Emirates, unequivocally condemned what happened, which itself is unusual, but not others were silent, afraid of their people still.
The United States was wholeheartedly in the presence of Joe Biden, supportive at the beginning. We now read about differences, principally because of the civilian casualties and perhaps differences between Biden and Netanyahu. How serious is that? And what are the implications of that?
It's very serious because Netanyahu is basically, on the one hand, accepting America's massive military resupply of Israel, which is going on every day with one hand, and the with the other hand, he's running against Joe Biden, specifically running against Joe Biden to remain prime minister in Israel. How so? Netanyahu is declaring that the Palestinian Authority will have no role in Gaza, and that there'll never be a Palestinian state in the West Bank or Gaza, at a time when the U.S. president is saying that for Israel to enjoy long-term American support and to generate the kind of economic aid for Gaza that it will need to rebuild there, there has to be a political horizon for Palestinian. The Palestinian Authority has to be involved. And ultimately, not tomorrow, no one expects it tomorrow, the next day, but we have to be on a pathway again of two states for two people. And so Netanyahu is running 180 degrees in opposition to Joe Biden in order to stay in power.
In fact, arguing or saying to his colleagues on the right, I'm the only person that can stand up.
Right. Yeah.
Joe Biden.
It's, I mean, in the middle of a really existential war, Israel's prime minister is running for president, or running for re-election, excuse me.
What about a wider war? In the beginning, there was a great fear that there may be a war with Hezbollah. There was worry about what might happen in terms of Iran's influence. We see the Houthis are now sending drones over at American warships. Has the presence of American warships eliminated that possibility for the most part?
Yeah, I think there's been a lot of American diplomacy to prevent Iran and Hezbollah from jumping into this war with 2 feet. I would say military diplomacy as well, in terms of how we move troops. It hasn't gotten a perfect result, because I think a lot of these militias, while they're pro-Iranian, supplied by Iran, and Iran's deeply enmeshed with them, I don't think Iran just flips a switch and turns them on and off. They have minds of their own, and some of them have been really, you know, trying to break their leash, as it were, I think also. But, you know, as I've been saying, we have two aircraft carriers in the Middle East, aircraft carrier groups, one in the Eastern Mediterranean and one in the Persian Gulf. And Iran has what I would call, Charlie, four landcraft carriers. They're called Houthis, Hamas, Hezbollah, and Shia militias in Iraq. And they are, like our aircraft carriers, they are platforms for Iran to project power. And it's been using them very adeptly. That one reason I think it's important for Israel, again, to get out of Gaza as soon as it can, is that nothing would deter Hezbollah more than to know that Israel is free, you know, from Gaza, and could focus 100% on Hezbollah if it needed to. And so, not to mention the Houthis. But that's why getting out pays so many dividends.
Some argue that the only way that Iran will stop supporting, as you say, those four, is for to attack Iran at the source, to attack Iran in some way. Does that argument have merit for you?
Well, you know, there's no question that I think Iran is a hugely malign actor in the region, but there's also no question that I think no one has the stomach for attacking Iran. And for Israel, it could be devastating to its economy. There would be a terrible missile, you know, a barrage on Israel. And so I think we need to leave Iran for the Iranian people.
But that was one of the things driving the Abraham Accords.
Yes, the fear of Iran, definitely. And that didn't work out well for Iran. I mean, it's finding itself isolated. Again, to go back to why this war started, Charlie, I think it's very simple from 30,000 feet. What was going on in the world on October 6th is that Ukraine was trying to join the West. Israel was trying to join the East through normalization with Saudi Arabia. And Russia and Iran wanted to block both.
Back to the people who at Hamas, who the leadership and where they are, and what would happen if the IDF would leave. Another idea that you had suggested was not having much more of a stealth effort to get them, in the same way that Golda Meir after Munich, I think. sent Mossad out to get the people who'd organized that assault on Israeli athletes. Is that a viable idea?
You know, I think it was at the time, but it's now a moot point, frankly. But if Israel were again to get out in return for its hostages and an internationally supervised ceasefire, and Sinwar had to come out of his tunnel, which he will at some point, Israeli security people have already been quoted that we will find you, and someone else will raise your children, is what they've said.
And there's reason to take them seriously if you talk to Iranian scientists or talk to.
Yeah.
Why has it been so hard to find them?
Well, I would say I would step back and again, from 30,000 feet, one of the big things I've learned from this whole conflict is that Hezbollah, Hamas, we talk about them, Charlie, sometimes as militias because they're non-state actors. In fact, these are armies. These are armies with brigades and divisions, command and control structure. And we now know from Hamas, their own defense industry in the tunnels. They are much more potent military forces that the world will have to think about long after this war, how these now non-state groups can amass state-like armies and what that means for global stability.
Knowing what you know and what has been written about Sinwar, can you ever expect he would give up the hostages?
I don't know, Charlie. I think he'll do whatever is in his survival interest. But you're asking the right question. I do believe there's been a lot of reporting that some of the young women hostages have been sexually abused in captivity. And I think Hamas is afraid of what stories they will tell. I fear that's also at work here. And so I just don't know. Very hard for me. I've never met him. Very hard to get in his head. Mm-hmm. I think it's a pretty dark place, though.
Where is Israel politically? I've read stories in the Times and other places that, at the moment, it's more conservative, that people are feeling and things that they hadn't felt before. Clearly, they don't want Benjamin Netanyahu as their prime minister, and every poll indicates that. But where are they in terms of the kind of government they want?
I think we have to remember Netanyahu's support is not zero. I mean, he still has a significant following, but I think he's also lost a lot of support here. The Israel has been moving to the right politically on this issue. Ever since the collapse of the 2000 Camp David negotiations with Ehud Barak, who I know you talked to recently, and which was then followed by a wave of suicide bombing and the second Intifada. And so that kind of got a lot of Israelis just washed their hands from it. And then nothing kind of happened since, because those were the most of the 16 years Netanyahu was in power, and he made sure that there was no peace process. And he was basically on a pathway, he thought, to proving to the world that he could have not just peace with the Arabs, he could have normalization with Saudi Arabia and not give the Palestinians anything. That's what he was about. That's what he was all about on October 6th. On October 7th, Hamas said, that's not going to happen. And that is one of the reasons I think it went to war. But I think there was also a lot of infighting in Hamas between outsiders and insiders, and who knows what calculations go on there.
They're in the end fighting over land that they both believe, Palestinians and the Israelis, that they have a historic right to. Why do you think that they can ever, ever live side by side? Because lots of people have written that they would like to see a two-state solution, but they just don't think it is ever possible.
The only thing that makes me think of Charlie is the alternative, because you're looking at it now, and people can't live this way either. And so I do think separation is the answer. I've always believed it was the answer. Israelis and Palestinians, when they're secure each in their own place, actually, I think can get along very well and cooperate, collaborate, you know, and have a lot in common. But first, they need to live apart. And I just think that after this war, again, people will say after this war, no way, no how, never. And other people will say, this shows you what happens when you say no way, no how, never. And we've got to explore whether there is a different course, because both communities now, I would say, are suffering more from the Israeli-Palestinian conflict than any time since the War of Independence for Israel, 1947, 1948.
Suffering more.
Yeah. Psychologically, physically, economically, this is the worst.
And do those Arab friends, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, Jordan, do they feel that too? Do they feel that it's now time to move on? It's time to sort of find a way to and support the establishment of a two-state solution and do everything, whether it means rebuilding Gaza, whether it means making deals?
Yeah, I think you would find a lot of support in the Gulf, in Saudi Arabia, in the UAE in particular, to be supportive of a real peace process.
So that's the crucial thing there, a real process.
Yeah. And I, again, you know, it took 6 months after the Yom Kippur War, Charlie, for Golda Meir to be removed for that failure. So where this war hasn't even stopped yet. I mean, but I do believe there will be leadership transitions in Israel and the Palestinian community. And out of those transitions, I believe, I hope, there will be another go at this, Charlie. Can't tell you exactly how, but there'll be another go at it, of some kind of peace negotiation.
And I read that from you emotionally, as well as intellectually, as well as what you have said professionally. More than simply the triumph of hope over experience. I read that from your standpoint as that the alternative is simply unacceptable. That's the reason this has to be.
Probably too many people have access now to too many weapons that amplify their power at an accelerating rate and are being democratized with a small d, spread to more and more people. And this is just no way to live. And they've got to explore an alternative. And I believe they will when this war is over. I think Netanyahu has been a uniquely destructive person for this, but he's had lots of help from a dysfunctional also Palestinian leadership in the PA and mendacious Palestinian leadership in Hamas.
Who is the future Israeli leadership?
It's a very good question, Charlie. And if I take you back to October 6th, what we were witnessing in Israel was actually one of the most remarkable political phenomena I'd ever seen. A country that was turning out over half a year, every Saturday night,
exactly,
of over 100,000 people every Saturday night.
And led by non-politicians.
Right. To oppose Netanyahu's judicial coup, led by people from the tech community, the social, entrepreneurship community, all kinds of people. And I believe out of that group, which morphed when the war started into a autonomous sort of civil defense unit, defense in the sense that getting resources, whether it was bulletproof vests or food and food packets to the military at the front, because the government had so failed in its functions. And so that group has spawned a whole new generation of Israeli leaders. And I think you will see them come to the fore when the guns fall silent. And I hope the same is true on the Palestinian side.
It's needed. You were at the Dubai conference and lots of other nations were there. I want to talk a little bit about that. But when you were there, I assume you had a chance to talk to people from China and people from other countries. How do they see this war? Do they see this war as something that they wish was not there?
I think, you know, China was very disappointing, frankly, Charlie. This is how this war started. Let's go back to October 7th. I mean, Hamas broke a ceasefire and engaged in acts of cross-border barbarism. That should be a pretty easy one for China to call out. After all, it doesn't want to suffer the same thing itself. And it really prevaricated, as did Russia, as did Putin. And that's because Putin is appealing to the global South because he wants their support against Ukraine. China's always,
they want to sell them energy.
Yeah, and also China, always looking, to steal a march on America and somehow, deprive it of influence. Very disappointing, and China hurt itself in Israel. Israel's a very important technology source and partner for China, because it punches way above its weight, and Israelis will not forget this. And the same with Putin.
Any serious progress made at that conference?
Yeah, I think, these global COPs, these UN climate conferences, I've been to a lot of them now since Bali. And, what they're really about, Charlie, is getting more and more people energized about mitigating climate change. And so if you think of that issue as having had that kind of slope 20 years ago and now I think it has a positive slope. More and more people. Darren Woods, the head of CEO of ExxonMobil, was at the COP for the first time.
Yeah.
But what ExxonMobil's doing in terms of capturing carbon out of the atmosphere. Some of it's hype always, but even the fact that they feel the need to come and hype it is a good thing. We are not going to mitigate climate change at the speed, scope, and scale we need. That's the bad news. The good news, though, is at least the effort now has a positive slope that it did not have 10 years ago. And more people are being driven by the right market incentives to do the right thing, because that's what gives you scale.
When you look at Israel and the Middle East, a place where you had did brilliant reporting and continue to do brilliant reporting, perhaps better than you've ever done, and you think about the future, are you more worried about the future of your own country and what's happening here politically?
Well, I've often said that Israel is to wider trends in America what Off-Broadway is to Broadway.
Yes, you have.
So you see a lot of things happen there in miniature. I mean, Trump and Netanyahu are brothers from different mothers. Netanyahu is smarter academically, but they both have one real similarity that is deeply destructive for democracy. Their whole way of taking power, winning elections, is by dividing people. Divide, 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 divide. For Bibi, it was divide Ashkenazi Jews from Sephardic Jews, religious from secular, Tel Aviv from Jerusalem, liberals from conservatives, ultra-Orthodox from less religious. He sought to divide, divide, divide the Israeli public till he could win by 50.00001. That's all he ever wanted. Same with Trump. Trump's a divider. He's not a uniter. And both are trying to use the court system in order to keep themselves in power. Both have been charged with different kinds of corruption. They're identical, and both unique threats to their societies. And the only good thing I'll say about both is that God only made one Donald Trump, and God only made one Netanyahu. And I do believe when they leave the scene, respectively, it'll open up a different kind of politics in both countries.
Joe Biden clearly reads your column. He has said so, or his friends have said so. He is interested in what you think. If he asks you, what he should do with respect both to the foreign issue of the war, both wars, Ukraine and Israeli Hamas, and secondly, what he should do about his own campaign here. What would you say?
Well, you know, I think that
And defining the threat that he sees.
Yeah, I've been supportive of what the president's done on Ukraine. I think it's been absolutely essential and courageous. And, you know, if Ukraine can escape free of Russia's grasp, even if it is a Ukraine that Russia still holds 17% of and brought into the European Union, wow, that would so strengthen and widen Europe and advance a Europe whole and free. It'd be hugely important. And Ukraine is a big country. It has now the biggest, most experienced land army in Europe. It's an agricultural breadbasket, and it produces massive amounts of engineering talent. And so bringing that country into the European Union would really strengthen the
EU. But it's at a very, very difficult place right now, as you well know.
No, and that's why I worry about it, and that's why I support what the president's doing. You know, I've actually been working on a book, Charlie, and one of the chapters is about what's the best thing I saw in my career.
And that's one of my questions, by the way.
Well, I surprise people by saying the best thing that happened in my career was the creation of the European Union.
Really?
Yeah, because, you know, Americans will do anything for the EU except read about it. But the fact is, in your lifetime and mine, Charlie, a continent known only for tribal and religious wars, together and created the biggest center of free markets, free people, the rule of law, democracy, and human rights. A second United States was born, the United States of Europe. Not exactly like ours, but a lot of similarities. How lucky are we to live in a world with two United States and not just one? And the whole world we live in would be so different were it not for the presence of this European Union.
And when you think about the size and the power and the GDP of the European Union, and you think about what has become more apparent is the power of NATO because of Ukraine and because of what the American president has done to rally them.
These are another
awareness of the power of working together.
Yeah. And there is no problem we can solve in the world today alone, not strategic, not climate, not economic. And I think Joe Biden has done a superb job of basically reconsolidating America's relationship with these giant multilateral institutions that have served the world so well. So I'm a big fan of his. You know, I think what he's done vis-a-vis Israel and Hamas and understanding that Israel had a right to respond, but trying to shape that response in a way that doesn't devastate Gaza's civilian population, innocent civilian population, not entirely effective in that effort, I would say, which is why I've written a column today, Friday, you know, urging the president to bring some more tough love to this story and really engage with the Israelis on getting a ceasefire in return.
So your column anticipates my question.
Yeah. So it's we're thinking the same way still. So I think Biden's done a good job, you know, and
he should run again.
You know, I don't have a position on that, Charlie, because he is running again. And so, and because he is, I'm going to do everything I can with my little white space in the New York Times to support him. Because as I've told everyone who reads my column, I just write about three things now, Charlie. I write about Ukraine, I write about Israel, and I write about Trump. Because if Ukraine goes Putin, if Israel goes autocratic, and if America goes Trump, the world that my new little grandson and granddaughter is going to grow up in will be so much worse than the one I grew up in.
So combine what you just said with these four things. One, nuclear. Two, biology. Three, climate. Four, technology. Are you in the end optimistic or pessimistic?
Well, you know, I always, you know, in my book, I explain my worldview, actually, and my worldview, and you will understand this immediately since we've talked so many times, is a cross between Walter Mondale and Thomas Hobbes. So I have a, yes. I have this sort of Minnesota optimism. And then I was a Minnesota boy who went to Beirut and discovered the jungle, you know, the Hobbesian jungle. And so there's always that tension in what I write. And but as long as I have a voice and a platform at the New York Times, and I will come out swinging for solutions. I will not fall prey to pessimism. It's not what I do. And I don't think it's anything we can afford. And there's enough people doing pessimism that I can sort of corner the hopeful market, the solution-oriented market. And
artificial intelligence makes the solution specter.
Again, with all of these things, there are massive upsides, there are massive downsides, and the role of government is to cushion the downsides and get the best out of the upsides. And that's whatever technology you're talking about. And it was true with
the and sometimes referee.
Yeah. And so I think that's why government is so important now, more important than ever, as machines get this powerful and as we get this integrated as a world. And so I'm the thing that just worries me the most and is that we are the world, folks. We the United States. I don't say that out of any jingoism. I really believed in Madeleine Albright's. We are the indispensable nation. And if I look at the world I cover, Charlie, for 45 years now, it was really defined by three things. It was defined by strong America, engaged with the world in upholding liberal institutions and multilateral institutions that kept the world more free, more open, more democratic. That was one pillar. Second pillar was actually a growing China that grew 6% every year and really buoyed the world economy and drove globalization.
And provided products and markets.
For a lot of people. And the third is stable borders in the developing world. When I look around today, I see a lot of those borders fracturing and their people migrating north, whether it's from Africa across the Mediterranean to Europe or across Mexico to the United States. When I look at China today, I see a country that actually has kind of made a U-turn from its path of gradual opening to the world, no longer growing as well. And as young people want to make a U-turn, a lot of them out of the country entirely. And when I look at America, I see the prospect of us electing a man who mounted the first insurrection against an election in modern history. And we're playing with fire here because when all these things start to fracture and go kaflooey, you know, your 401k may be okay today, but you may wake up one day when all of these things really start to matter. And so voting for Donald Trump, that may seem like fun and entertaining. It's not funny at all. And it's not entertaining at all. Now, that doesn't mean we should give Democrats a free pass. You know, I happen to be a hardliner on the border. I've said many times, I'm for a high wall with a big gate. I think you should have to ring the doorbell if you want to come into my country. I don't buy any of this crazy woke stuff on campuses where president of a major university can't, you know, call out that advocating genocide is simply not going to happen on my campus. And so there's a lot of these trends that I worry about because I think a lot of what drives Trump is opposition to those trends and feeling that he is the guy who will put a stop to it. So I think Democrats have to be very smart and centered and understand where the center of the country is if we're going to see Democrats win this election.
What's the name of the book?
What You Say When You Listen.
You Say When You Listen.
Biggest lesson I got as a journalist in the Middle East, I learned that there's two things happen when you listen, Charlie. One is what you learn when you listen. All the stories I got wrong were because I was talking when I should have been listening. But secondly, listening is a sign of respect. And it's amazing what people would let me say to them, say about them, ask them about if they thought I respected them. people think you respect them, they'll actually let you ask anything. And if people think you don't respect them, you can't tell them the sky is blue. So the biggest lesson I learned in 45 years in journalism is what you say when you listen.
My life has been defined by listening.
I know that.
Thank you so much. I add one small point, or a larger point, an essential part of freedom is good journalism. It is the capacity to read the truth and to know the truth. And I commend you for the part that you have played in that. And I thank you for sharing this time with me.
Well, vice versa. Back at you, and Merry Christmas.
And to you.
Thanks.
Friedman from Washington. Thank you for joining us.